This program is brought to you by Dolku Media. Fixing South Sudan, ideas for the new nation. With award-winning journalist Madin Mor.
Absolutely.
Honorable Achim, as you can see, the ideas of the initiatives are varied.
On July 8th, the clashes in J1 took place, which was very unfortunate.
Including country-specific ones, which
the rebellion continue to be.
Fixing South Sudan, ideas for the new nation.
Hello and welcome to Fixing South Sudan,
your ideas for building the new nation.
I am Ateny Wek Ateny. This week on Fixing South Sudan, a look at the state of rule of law enforcement in South Sudan. Have we lost the battle to anchor the new nation on laws and constitutionalism? Is the rule of persons eclipsing the rules of the books? And is restoration, the rule of law, a good idea for fixing the new nation? Joining us for the program is Honorable Ateny Wek Ateny, the spokesman and press secretary of His Excellency, the President of the Republic of South Sudan, General Salva Kiir Mayardit. It's a pleasure to welcome him to this show. Welcome, sir.
Thank you so much, Madin. For the first time in your show.
Good to have you.
Thank you.
So let me take it this way. You are a lawyer by profession. Before your appointment, you were a member of the South Sudan National Constitutional Review Commission, which is a body tasked with producing a permanent constitution. What do we mean when we speak about rule of law?
Well, rule of law as a concept is a process that a country should be governed by law in a state of individual decisions. That law is to be above everyone. And any citizen, regardless of political status, regardless of political and religious affiliation, they must come under law. That's the concept of it. But the application of it is different.
Do we have rule of law in South Sudan?
Yes. We have rule of law, given that South Sudan, like any other country, has a codification, has laws that govern it. And the supreme law of South Sudan is the Constitution of South Sudan 2011, which derived, in which the government and citizen, derive their powers from it.
Why is it difficult for South Sudanese to follow through with the existing laws?
Well, it's about how far South Sudanese came to be where they are. Because, this is a country that was independence was actually gained after protracted war, very long protracted war, and that was the longest running civil war in Africa by the time the CPA was signed in 2005. So, owing to the fact that people were living in Sudan as if they are living tomorrow. So the concept that, went to the mind of South Sudanese is that they were marginalized in Sudan, and they were waiting for country of their own so that they can start educating themselves about how to do this or do that. So in the process, let's say the rule of law is difficult to implement in South Sudan, given the way that the country, started, the process that South Sudan started as a liberation. South Sudan started as a liberation movement until they gained independence eventually. So you find discrepancies within that.
During the CPA, there was an interim period that was given for South Sudan to prepare to be a nation, and then followed by the formal declaration of independence.
in 2011. The difficulties we are finding is it that there was no preparation made for South Sudan to achieve statehood, or is it the fact that South Sudanese did not want to obey the laws?
No, you know, even the interim period was bumpy. The 6 years that were given to South Sudanese to prepare themselves for a nationhood were being interrupted up and down by Khartoum. So, the general focus became like, we must do everything possible to ensure people of South Sudan has to exercise right to self-determination. So everybody was focusing on what mechanism that will allow South Sudan not to return to war before they cast votes on January 9, 2011. So every focus was there. There's no any preparation that was to prepare the mind of South Sudanese on how to be the citizen of a country they should be proud of, but only to make sure that they retaliate against Khartoum and make sure they have a country of their own. And then later on we start, you know, to educate ourselves on how to accept the nationhood. Even if you look at, when peace agreement was signed, there were also challenges. Even one of the difficulties we are in now today is because the CPA has alluded to the fact that the land should come to belong to community. It was done for the purpose of making Khartoum not to put its end on our land. But it came now something completely different, you know, and it is difficult now. That's what makes the communities now to almost, you know, be part of everything in the country, almost dictating everything.
On July 9th, 2011, the independence was declared. There was a lot of euphoria, a lot of joy. And then it only took 2 years or 3 years. And then South Sudan went into a violent conflict. What explains that eruption, that immediate eruption?
Well, if you look at the independent, everybody was joyful. But the politicians among the larger populations were having different calculations. As the independent was under President Salva Kiir, because President Salva Kiir was the first vice president in Khartoum, in Sudan, and therefore the president of government of Southern Sudan, he would be the one to hoist the flag. But already, before we gained independence, there were a talk in town that his vice president, his deputy, was willing to be the one hoisting the flag, owing to the tales of certain prophecies that, you know, the president of South Sudan should be somebody with gapped in his teeth and should be some left-handed and all this, which we don't apply to President Salva Kiir. And so after 2 years, the vice president started, talking to the president as if he ran another country, another government. And he's telling the president that the election of 2015, we cannot wait for election of 2015 because I will be too old by then. So I need to be the president now. When he's asked to wait for the time, he does not want to wait for the time. That now the question goes back to him. Is he still getting old now, or he's okay? Because Riek Machar caused this war, the war that is running in the country.
And what do you think is the cause of the war? Is it greed for power, or is it the fact that the laws that are enshrined, that are in place, are not fair for everyone?
Well, I think greed for power is there because, if Riek Machar, was to allow the president, to run the nation until 2015, and then they go to election, as the running mate, Riek Machar as running mate of the president, like in 2010, President Salva Kiir, by this time, would be on the position of talking about exit from power, if that was the case. But Riek Machar did not give President Salva Kiir time. He looked as if President Salva Kiir was already 20 years in power, when in actual fact, he was only 2 years by then. You cannot call the government of Southern Sudan as power if somebody has been there for 6 years, you cannot count, because there was no nation called South Sudan. That is why it was called Government of Southern Sudan.
What does it tell you that individuals would put their interests before that of the nation, before that of the supreme law of the country? Because elections and power transfer are governed by the constitution. Why the impatience? Is it the inability to enforce the law, or is it just sheer disregard for the law itself?
Well, I think it's about the nature of of the system that, you know, of the liberation movement that came actually to take power in South Sudan after the independence. Because at some times the movement has difficulties. There are a number of commanders that has shown discontent, you know, in the SPLA and formed their own militia group, and a number of other militia groups that were not completely part of the SPLA before. So, owing to the fact that the people of South Sudan wanted to reach, in, you know, independence by all means, you know, they have to be allowed, you know, to come back so that they are absorbed in the National Army. And National Army almost became closer to tribal. If you you see the characteristic of the army before the 2013. So, Dr. Riek Machar refused to accept the rule of law because of the majority he saw in his own tribal men within the army. And so he think he can tell the president what he want to tell the president.
Let me understand what you are saying. Are you attributing the current challenges to the failure of the liberation movement to put certain systems in place?
No, it's not a failure as such. But the movement was overwhelmed as it comes to sign the peace agreement. The clause within the peace agreement, the CPA, which says the militia that were used by Khartoum as counter-insurgent strategy must choose between going to South Sudan or remain with Khartoum. Our leaders saw it will be very difficult if you leave the 14 militia group, South Sudanese militia group in Khartoum. They would decide to fight. And if they fight, the referendum cannot be conducted. So they have to be allowed to come back.
And accommodation was made. Juba Declaration was consummated in 2006.
And it was not even done the way it should have been done, because, you know, during the Anyanya, there has to be the merits, you know, in order for you to be absorbed to the army. It was done on merits. That is why the only 2,000 soldiers from Greater Equatoria, 2,000 from Greater Balazar, 2,000 from Greater Upper Nile. So the whole Anyanya was, confined to only 6,000. So that you apply things like somebody who is fit, somebody who has the capacity to be taken for training. But that one was not done in 2006. The Juba Declaration accepted all the militia as they were.
Thousands of troops from
Bolinomati. Even those who have never been to militia one time, because of looking for a job, they came and put their name down, and they were taken. You know, some of them have ranks, high ranks in the army. They don't read, they don't write. Okay, they have never been an army officers before, and so that's also another challenge.
Is this a regret of the leadership that they should have not approached it the way they did?
No, the leadership did not have any other alternative. That's why I said they were overwhelmed. They did not have another alternative. The other alternative would have been to allow them, to allow those militia to remain in Khartoum. And the referendum would not have been achieved. So I cannot blame the leadership for accepting to sign Juba Declaration. There was no other alternative.
And would you say that decision affected the rule of law process in South Sudan?
Of course,
because it made it impossible to have a professional army.
Not all of it, but it's actually contributing in part. You know, if we looked critically at why it is difficult sometimes for us to be able to implement the rule of law, you look at this kind of behaviors that has been conceived, that if Madingor or Ateny Wek is with the government today, the moment they are out of government, then they would think to go back to the forest. It is like fish living in water. Fish dies outside when you take them outside the water. So our people should not be fish, like fish. If you are in government, then you are alive. If you are outside the government, you will think that you will not be alive, even if you have accumulated millions and millions of dollars. You see the behaviors of, you know, the
Why don't we take a break from there?
Okay, okay, thank you.
Welcome to Dorco Media Services. We have so many services for you, such as video production, camera hiring, sound system hiring, event management, passport photo, stand-up comedy, printing, drama, music, dance, multimedia, and photography. Dorco Media Services, our culture, our pride.
Welcome back to Fixing South Sudan, your ideas for building the new nation. I am Ateny Wek Ateny, and our topic, restoration of the rule of law as an idea for fixing the nation. And with us is Honorable Ateny Wek Ateny, the spokesman and press secretary of His Excellency General Salva Kiir Mayardit, the President of the Republic of South Sudan. We welcome you back, and we are talking about the fact that it is impossible for certain individuals to subject them through the rule of law when it comes to governance. When someone is removed, they rebel. And that is the challenge that you face since 2006. You were determining that if these militias were not absorbed, South Sudan will not get what it wants. Yes. So is that part of the problem for achieving rule of law in South Sudan?
Yes, I think it's part of the problem, and it's even a bigger part of the problem, simply because when certain people with power in their hands, you know, decide not to accept, you know, application of the law when it comes to their own, and they would want the rule of the law to be applied to others, there's a problem there, because one of the fundamental principle of the law is that law must be general, applied to everybody. Mading or myself, anybody in this country, you know.
The president?
The president is actually not above the law. The president, okay, was elected using the law, because he did not go there by force. He was elected, and therefore he's not above the law. So if a law applied to everybody, then the law will be said to be a good law. But when the law is not applied to everybody, it's called draconian law.
Now, who is the problem? Is it those who are not enforcing the laws that exist, or those who are rejecting them, subverting them?
Well, those who are actually rejecting to apply the rule of law, or to accept
that
the rule of law.
Those who are not applying are the government.
Those who are actually, who are refusing, okay, or resisting the rule of law, okay, are the problem, because they are even more powerful. You know, some of them are trying to be more powerful than the state itself. If you look at that behaviors, okay, you would find that, you know, we need as South Sudanese to make sure that the coming generation is to be taught differently than this kind of teaching, that you cannot see yourself secure unless you are in the government.
And there is no rule of law if there is no accountability.
Yeah, of course, accountability is at central stage. Accountability, but how do you account for anybody who have done? Because even a simple person, you know, even a simple method that Mading is no longer a minister today, or is no longer chief of staff, or is no longer commander of a certain division, okay? The next thing for us is to see Mading, you know, preparing to fight. That's a bigger problem.
So are you saying the government cannot subdue individuals,
well,
however powerful?
In the long run, the government ought to make sure that individuals are not allowed to bully the government and bully people of South Sudan.
Is this the reason why those who have rebelled, who have killed South Sudanese, are brought in, accommodated, awarded for wrong things? Is it because they are more powerful than the state?
No, the problem is when you are looking on, you know, on a solution, a solution to any problem must be on the table. If a solution comes to the table and then also, you know, you did not defeat the person that was fighting you to oblivion, okay, and you eventually you'll have to come to the table. Even if you defeat, like the Tamil Tigers were completely defeated, but the problem of Sri Lanka has not finished yet. Even if you defeat somebody militarily, you still need to talk, because there is a reason for any fighting.
Accommodation policy is an amicable settlement.
Accommodations is simply because you have no other option. When you look at why people are rebelling, they rebel in order to come and get another position. This is what, but it has to be discouraged, because if we continue like that, even the coming generation will also have, will adapt to this. Okay? It must be discouraged.
Would you say those policies are promoting disregard for rule of law, so that individuals get what they want?
Of course, even individuals, decide, to rebel simply because he was or she was removed from the office. That he was thinking or she was thinking that he should have been there for life. And then they go and then later on come back with a higher position than what they were. Then that is a bad teaching. You teach people about disregard to the rule of law, when in actual fact, any country must adhere to, a citizen must adhere to the rule of law.
Let me come back to your own personal contribution to the development of rule of law. From the time you were a civil society activist, and then you were beating the drum of the truth. And now you are in J1,
yes,
the State House,
yes,
speaking for the most powerful man in South Sudan. Is it this idea that if you can beat them, you join them? Have you joined them?
No, that's not the case. First of all, I was appointed as press secretary, and I did not lobby. I did not lobby for the position. But the end results of anybody in civil activism is either to join the government as one, okay, and then bring your ideas, apply them while in the government, or you take the government as whole through the election. There are civil society activists that has taken governments because they campaign, and then they went to the point of forming a political party at the closer to election. So I think that was a way for me to contribute in the process of nation building.
And have you made positive contributions in your 6 years as press secretary?
It's 4 years, But I have contribution. I cannot be judged by indicators because I'm not like Minister of Education or Minister of Health, because Minister of Education and Minister of Health can be judged by indicators. Saying when I came here as Minister of Health, malaria used to kill 200 children a month, now has reduced to 5. I am working with the biggest man, okay? I'm working as a support staff for the president, the head of the state. So no matter what I wanted to change, I can only change through him, and I cannot talk about it.
And have you changed anything?
Yeah, I think, all things that are happening, also the hallmark of what we do, because the nation is run by everybody, of course. Even the office of the president, anybody, even the cleaner, is contributing. Because if the cleaner doesn't clean the office environment will not be good for anybody working there.
We talk of fixing South Sudan agenda. Is it an agenda that you think is good for the nation?
No, it's very good. We need to fix South Sudan. And I agree with the title itself, because with somebody like you trying to fix it, you should be helped in order to fix South Sudan, because we have no any other country.
Has Ateny Wek fixed South Sudan, or has South Sudan fixed Ateny Wek?
No, I am fixing South Sudan, because South Sudan is not fixing me. I'm 54 years old, and I have only 4 years in the office of the president. So I've lived longer than the time I spent in the office of the president. So, it is not South Sudan, fixing me. The government is not the one fixing me, but I'm one of the people who are fixing, the country, you know, the country.
In your 4 years, there must have been time where you have been proud of your work, of your association, proximity to the President of the Republic. And what has your proximity to the President brought to the nation? What are the things that you think you have done that you can be proud of as a result of your association with the President?
Well, I cannot talk about much in that regard, simply because I am as like advisor to the President on issue of media and the public relations. If I have to advise the President on given issue, I cannot come and brag or, you know, talk about it in the public. But the good thing in this is that I have good relationship with the President, because I have come to understand him closely. Because last time when I was writing in The Citizen, maybe I was writing on assumption of who was President Salva Kiir. But now I know him. This is a person that has a heart for this nation. And the fact that he joined Anyanya when he was less than 20 years old, and joined the Second War again, you know, for 21 years, it was not a coincidence. President Salva Kiir have a vision for this country. So I am not here to talk about, and even my job is not to talk about myself, what I've done. But I am to talk about what President Salva Kiir has done for the nation. So I leave what I have done to the people to judge the way they want to judge me.
When you talk about those who are judging what the President has done, many people are saying that the economy has gone wild, has taken up arms against the state. You have rebellions cropping up. You have thousands of people, if not millions, depending on the estimates, have been displaced. There is widespread hunger. There is a crisis in South Sudan. So, knowing the President, how do we now, and in that environment, you cannot achieve rule of law. Knowing the President, what is he prepared to do to restore the rule of law and constitutionalism in South Sudan?
First of all, I would want to say the issue of why our economy is not good is the responsibility of all. The people of South Sudan, majority of them, decided not to be working. Okay, not to even cultivate. And the land is so fertile, so we have no any diversification of the economy. It is only everybody, like, you know, as a tired to wait for the oil producing proceeds to be the one that feeding everybody, and people refused, you know, to take work seriously. At the time when we were in Sudan, you know, our people were the one building those high buildings in Khartoum, were the one who were actually making roads. But when they came here, they allowed the Ugandan and Kenyans, you know, to take those jobs. And then they are just sitting under trees talking about what government has done wrong.
What is the president prepared to do to restore rule of law?
The President first, you know, has been pushed to find himself in this situation by those who are greed for power. They who want to be president using shortcuts, you know. So the President, you know, agenda now is to make sure that South Sudan return to normalcy first.
How?
Well, by making peace available on part of the President. The President wanted the revitalization of the peace agreement or resolution of conflict.
National dialogue
to bring peace back to South Sudan. And then South Sudanese make sure that, you know, they undo the polarization that others are doing against them. Okay? When President Salva Kiir sees South Sudan back to normalcy, okay, then the next thing you want to see, because he's a person that who respect the rule of law. And if I tell you, even sometimes there are things that happen and President Salva Kiir would categorically say, this is against the law, you know. But sometimes because of a situation, you know, the country has got itself in. So you are choosing now between applying strictly the rule of law and make sure that the country is completely distorted. We need to bring communities to their senses, because communities think they are the one running the government.
The President wants a peaceful, stable, South Sudan, and prosperous South Sudan.
Yes. This is what he wants. He wants everybody to be in peace. If everybody is in peace, then the country can flourish. Yeah.
How can South Sudan be fixed?
It's by making sure that Madingor, Ateny Wek, President Salva Kiir, everybody respect, you know, the fact that a country, okay, is to be run, okay, by laws.
Ateny Wek Ateny, thanks for coming on Fixing South Sudan.
Thank you so much.
And that is Fixing South Sudan, your ideas for building the new nation. With me, Madingor, what is your idea for fixing the nation? Join me for one-on-one discussion.